Good evening and welcome back to International Playoffs 2018 here in A Coruña in Spain. Brought to you by the Women's Flat Track Derby Association and Asbestas Roller Derby. Well, we have one hell of a game coming up for you. I am Brom.
I'm Scarlett Arroyo.
And thank you so much for joining us this evening. And this is the gold and silver medal game. We know both of these teams are going to be going to champs. But here, the absolutely beautiful medals for the game. And very shortly, we're going to be bringing you both of the teams as arch-rival Roller Derby is going to take on the Crime City Rollers. So, without much further ado, were you here for the Crime City Rollers game yesterday?
I called that game. It was incredible. I don't think I've ever seen a comeback like that in playoffs ever. And it was super exciting. So I think they're going to give them a run for their money for sure. But right now we need to get to our rosters. Would you like to start us off?
I absolutely will. And playing in black, we're going to have arch rival Roller Derby or the Crop Top Girl Gang. They are 1057 Shearer Powers, 121 Smarty McFly, 14 Psycho Kid Freakout, 15 Bolt Action, 1853 Vicious Van Gogo, 1900 Cloak and Dragger, 23 Pegasus, 26 Fletcher, 33 Jemiza Bush, 48 Brictator, 500 Grant, 501 Reptar, 68 Swanson, 718 Lux Furious, 810 K Woodward, and Bench Code Adam and Saints.
And skating yellow today, the Crime City Rollers all the way from Malmo, Sweden. I will give them to you in just a minute because we are about to get underway here in beautiful A Coruña, Spain. Who is out on the jam line first?
So we are seeing Brictator for arch rival who are playing in black. And in yellow, Crime City Rollers, Curly Hair, who isn't lead at the moment. Brictator coming straight in for that scoring pass.
Brictator, I know, one of those skaters that I've seen a lot of Twitter activity about. There are a lot of people's derby crush because she is a phenomenal skater and really has a maneuverability to her that makes a huge difference for Arch.
So Pack Advantage going into the second jam will sit with with Arch Rival as Crime City Rollers blocker currently just at the end of the jam went off to the quad skate shot penalty box.
Alrighty, and now we have a new pair of jammers out on the line. It looks like from Arch Rival, it's going to be Swanson, number 68, facing off against Hannah Pei.
So Hannah Pei coming up against the pack on the inside, while Swanson immediately stretching out the pack to pick up lead for Arch Rival.
Very tight pack still at turn one. Not a lot of forward momentum here in this jam.
Swanson bulldozes through the Crime City wall.
And we have a star stash on the Crime City side. Hannah Pei hiding the star as much as possible. And we have an official star pass over to the pivot from Crime City, Dykestalker. Dykestalker was one of those relief players in last night's game, that really big comeback, was a frequent acceptor of the star. And here we get to see that initial pass busting through that wall. Phenomenal work. A swing and a miss there by Dykestalker in the front.
Yeah, so in the first couple of minutes, no penalties currently picked up by Arch Rival, just two sitting on the Crime City side.
And no points for Crime City just yet.
As we see Curly Hair for Crime City and Psycho Kid, the freakout for Arch Rival. Curly Hair looking for a gap on the outside, pushes the pack slightly forward. Kid gets taken to the outside and being recycled back at exactly the same time as Curly Hair. It's a race of who can get there quicker. And it is Kid for Arch Rival. Comes in for that scoring pass.
Nice defensive work right there by Crime City's pivot. Trying to hold back Kid.
Curly Hall tries to take the outside line of turn one. Gets knocked back.
Helmet cover has been removed by Curly Hall. And a grand slam has been grabbed by Kid.
And we've seen an attempted star pass, a bit of juke out, as Curly Hoare uses that opportunity to complete the initial pass. Kidd keeping one eye back on Curly Hoare and the bench and calls it off just in time to keep Crime City shut out and at zero. A 14-point jam by Kidd there to take them to 27 points.
Beautiful footwork, barely staying in on the edge of that line, but does manage to do so. Gets forward, breaks up those last two defenders from Crime City. Now, we've talked a bit about the penalty box, and it's not playing too much of a factor yet, but it played a huge factor in last night's game. So let's get back to the action on the track. Who's jamming?
So we have Hannah Pay for Crime City, arch rivals Reptar. Hannah Pay looking like she's going to get some ground, but gets taken off, recycled back. Quick offense, defense, switching happening from both sides.
That was like a synchronized jammer spin. Like they both went on the left leg at the same time and rotated right at turn one. Hanape now through that back and eligible to score points, but Reptar in control of that clock.
Yeah, Reptar shutting down Hanape and denying the opportunity for Crime City to get away from that zero mark at the moment. We've seen 2 points picked up by arch rival. Community orientated like no other, Quad Skate Shop is passionate about getting you whatever you want faster, cheaper, and friendlier. Check them out in-store or online at quadrollerskateshop.com.
We have an official timeout on the track. I believe it's for track maintenance, which gives us a golden opportunity to tell you about our broadcast announcer backdrop sponsor, Adam Skates. Savant wheels by Adam are light, fast, and responsive. Everything you look for in a wheel.
Absolutely. And let's take a look at those Crime City roster as well. You've got 0030 D Mao, 0347 Hannah Pay, 1 below me, 100 Curly Hoare, 180 Phoenix Fortsome Fan, 26 Velvet Crush, 27 Bricken, 304 Nagan, 321 Ragnar Ponycat Rocket, 43 Les Roll, 53 Dyke Sulker, 610 Sexual Harassment, 79 Goldie Blocks, 858 Miss 10. Miss A. Tenlin and 9 kicks. Dr. Steeble and Friggin' Fury on the bench.
Now out on the jam line, or out wearing the stars, I should say, are Bricktator and Ponycat. Bricktator jumped out and grabbed lead jammer as we were introducing you to the team in yellow. And Bricktator now, before I could finish my sentence, has jumped out and grabbed 5 points as well.
Ponycat has removed the star. It's currently held in hand as recycled to the start of Term 1.
Oh, we have a low block called on Bricktator. This could be a game changer, Brom.
Yeah, this could be the first points we see for Crime City as the initial pass completed by Ponycat and comes in now for a scoring pass.
Yeah, in last night's game, Crime City was at a pretty significant deficit of well over 40 points, or just about 40 points going into the second half. And it was jams like this where Angel City had their jammers in the box that Crime City took full advantage and racked up points left and right.
Both teams are down one blocker apiece as arch rivals Pegasus returns to the track, followed very closely by Bricktator. But look, Ponycat being recycled back to the start of turn 4.
Now, Ponycat wasn't necessarily a huge point scorer in last night's game. However, it looks like right now she's the one that's making a difference. I think Arch has studied Curly Hoare and Hanape's movements, but Ponycat could be that wild card that the Crime City needs.
Absolutely. Bricktator's awareness of the track boundaries is just second to none. The control as she came through the inside of turn 4, just on an absolute inch to get through and pick up the scoring pass.
And we have an even jam right now in terms of points, 10 all. So a wash currently. However, both jammers had to recycle. Bricktator being pulled back behind the jam line before Ponycat calls it off. 4 points for Crime City, 5 points for Bricktator on that pass. Bricktator coming out on top of that one with 15, Crime City with 14, and on the board.
So have you got any questions for us, or if you want to share memes and GIFs and your comments and insights on the game, we're also on Twitter. So get in touch using the handle at WFTDA Live and the hashtag #talk2WFTDA.
I'm also a big fan of pets of WFTDA, like dogs in particular. All right, back to the action on the track. We have Crime City's number one point scorer for both of their games here this weekend, Carly Hoare. And for arch rival, that is Swanson.
So Swanson's pushing up front at the start of turn one. Crime City doing an incredible job of trying to hold Swanson at the front. Just gets through to pick up lead for arch rival. Curly Hoare, in the meantime, having a tough time against that black defense.
Now out on the track, Swanson is really making some moves, and now on a first scoring pass, grabs a handful the natural way. And in their games last over the weekend, Swanson's been at 73% in terms of lead jammer status acquisition. So I wonder if she's going to keep up that pattern of very high control of that clock.
And just take a moment to appreciate that with only two Crime City blockers on the track, Swanson definitely had the speed taken off her for a moment. But now it looks like we're going to see some return to the track from Crime City's blockers, but they've been frozen in. So pack advantage will sit with arch rival as we go into jam seven.
Now, although arch rival managed to put 14 points on the board in that particular jam, that was actually a really effective penalty kill by Crime City's remaining blockers. Only two of them left out on the track, but the fact that there were not more passes is a testament to the individual skills from each of those players. And when you put all that together, that's when you get that Crime City Scandinavian triangle of doom, if you will. Next on the jam line, who do we have?
So we have Psycho Kid, the freak out, who has immediately picked up lead. That last line of defense was phenomenal. And then a back block penalty has been given. So we have a power jam for Hannah Pay. The first power jam for Crime City so far this game.
Well,
Bricktator. Yep.
Bricktator, that's how they got their first set of points. But it wasn't on Hanape's heels. Hanape responsible yesterday for a large chunk of Crime City's points. 49 points in the Angel City game and 58 points in the Santa Cruz game. So Hanape could close this gap.
Yeah, Hanape coming in for the second scoring pass. Pack picks up a bit of speed, starts to slow down as it approaches turn three. Breaks through to add another 4 points onto Crime City's score.
Already closing that gap, and Kid is out of the box. Now, I guess they're going to have to redo that initial pass because they were called out on that initial pass. And Kid gets through on the inside with a stash.
Yep.
We have whistles being blown.
Hanape deciding to call that one to an end. Happy with the 17 points that have just been added to Crime City's score, putting them at a total of 31 against 59.
Here's that replay where we had the penalty committed, I believe.
And this last line of defense, though,
oh, beautiful
from
hit.
Below me, was just so well executed.
Now, Below Me was really bad about chasing just right there. Now, it resulted in a good thing as she was able to get that jammer takeout. However, last night she fouled out of the game, and a lot of those were for out of play. So she's got to watch how far she gets from her pack. Meanwhile, we are watching who on the track?
We have Reptile and Curly Hoare. Curly Hoare has already picked up lead, sailed straight through on the scoring pass to pick up the full 5 points.
Oh,
and
beautiful.
Again, two for two.
Well, speaking of two for two, this is Crime City's second lead jam in a row, and it is a power jam. No, just joking. Not a power jam.
I was just looking at the penalty box and noticing there were three arch rival blockers in the quad skate shop penalty box.
Oh,
two now back on the track.
I'm so sorry, Brom. The sneaky, sneaky star pass right there as Bolt Action is now taking over as the point scorer. They literally got this close to each other and handed it off below the belt line, and Bolt Action living up to the namesake, jumping out in front.
Can we also just take a moment to appreciate Bolt Action was simultaneously putting on the star whilst getting a scoring pass and turning 180 around the outside of turn one?
Psh, no big deal.
No big deal, just brushes that off.
Must be Tuesday.
But it has brought the two teams in incredibly close together. 13 points sits between them with 19 points picked up.
Okay,
for Crime
here's
City.
That juke, Curly Whore, just gliding through on that outside lane. No resistance because there were only two blockers on the track at the time. Oh, that was pretty.
So Pack Advantage is going to sit with Arch Rival, who just picked up 5 points in the last jam. And we're seeing an official timeout being called.
I believe this is a team timeout called by Arch Rival. And a golden opportunity for us to tell you, you need to take a timeout and think about your safety when you're playing. And a great way to do that is with S1 helmets. The S1 Lifer visor helmet is next level protection. I'm seeing more and more skaters out there with those sorts of things because, let's face it, an elbow to the nose is just no fun. Let's look at the penalties here, Brom.
Yeah, so if we take a look, we can see that Bricken in the first 13 minutes of the game has picked up 3 penalties, but elsewhere it's a relatively even spread right now.
Lots of direction of gameplay penalties by Crime City, actually.
So, there's a wonderful amount of gifts being shared expressing the love for these two teams on Twitter.
I'm expecting a gift specifically for the brush it off, no big deal.
All askew, actually giving a lot of love to the officials and the talent on the track from our officiating crew, demonstrating their excellence and feeling proud to know them. Thanks for sharing that, all askew.
So we saw Curly Whore really be the change agent there in that last jam, and that was absolutely the story yesterday. 117 points in our Santa Cruz game, 115 points in the Crime City game, and huge, huge momentum swing as possible. We have a continuing timeout on the track.
Yep. And that was signaled by Yoshi at the end that we're bringing an end to the official timeout. But Powerdyne plates and skate products, cutting-edge designs, cutting-edge performance.
Out on the jam line, we have Hanapay going up against Bricktator, two powerhouse jammers.
Hanapay using the outside, nearly controls around the outside of Arch Rival, but gets knocked out the last second. Up front, Bricktator juking around.
We have a direction of gameplay penalty on Arch Rival, but Bricktator uses the confusion to grab lead jammer status. Hanapay not far behind after a star stash.
And we're seeing Crime City's number 27 returning to the track at the end, but Arch Rival have one frozen in the box, and number 9 kicks just going off towards the end as well. So even setting as we go into Jam 10.
You know, we still have plenty of great derby here in Europe after this tournament is over, like the European Cup that's going to be taking place in Birmingham, I believe, in just a couple of weeks. So make sure you go get your watch passes at WFTDA.tv.
So Swanson for Arch Rival, Velvet Crush for Crime City. Velvet Crush immediately pushing up front. Swanson trying luck around the outside, doesn't quite manage it, so gets taken back. Velvet Crush pushing so hard against that Arch Rival wall, it looks like it might implode on itself. But look, not budging just yet, almost reaching that stalemate point between the two of them.
Nice offensive assist there by Arch Rival's number 23, Pegasus.
And look at that wonderfully timed hit from number 1 from below me again.
Swanson through for lead jammer status, 17 points separating these two teams.
Velvet Crush has lost her pivot to the penalty box, is currently holding the star in her hand, nearly completing half of the track before getting recycled again.
And if I'm not mistaken, Velvet Crush was kind of a relief jammer for Crime City, was only put in once or twice in last night's game. I think a newer skater to the team and is trying to prove her muscle out here on the track, quite literally trying to move that tripod of pink and black in the front.
Yeah, what an image to see the Arch Rival wall up front, really not giving an inch. And then at the back, we've got Swanson, who has come to a standstill after two amazing scoring passes.
two very graceful scoring passes, I'll say. Yeah. And now we have a successful star pass. So great job by Crime City on the penalty kill there. Just long enough for their pivot to get out of the box. But Swanson calls it off after grabbing, I believe, three more points. Total of 13, 30 points separating these two teams. All of Crime City's points have come in three jams of this half. Now, here's where we see that right out of the box pivot knocking out Swanson, and then a quick recycle back to grab the star.
Yeah, but so only 30 points sits between the two teams. And we're going to see Psycho Kid freak out, pick up lead incredibly quickly off the line. Curly Hall removing the helmet cover almost immediately once that lead was called. Pushing hard around the outside of turn two, comes back into the track, sees the opportunity to get the initial, while Kid comes through on the scoring pass. Hands poised, ready for the call-off, and there it is.
You know, as I know so many teams use that strategy of, I'm going to wait right until the other jammer gets up to that pack to call it off. But we saw that backfire yesterday in that game with Sailor City and Detroit. 1 point made that game.
In the last jam.
The very last jam, and it was just a slightly late call-off because they were waiting for the other jammer to hit that pack. So, they got to watch that down here because Crime City's jammers are quick and nimble, and now we have two new ones.
Hanapay takes a tumble to the floor. Bricktator is up front, putting speed behind Crime City Rollers. Bricktator picks up lead. Hanapay, no pass, no penalty, so comes round really hot on the heels of Bricktator. Bricktator goes straight into the back, calls it off, shuts out Crime City, but picked up two more for arch rival.
It was a really interesting exchange that happened right there where it really looked like Crime City was going to be able to sneak by on the inside. I think this is it right here. But the outside lane, it looked like right there, straight shot through, and I really thought she was going to be declared lead jammer. But then Bricktator, like she does, goes and knocks out Crime City's jammer.
There's that wonderful chant filling the arena for Crime City Rollers. Obviously, the European Roller Derby crowd has turned out in good force to join us here in A Coruña and respond well to the lead that has just been given to Curly Hoare.
Curly Hoare grabbing the jammer status once again. She's already done that. This is her second time here in this half.
Curly Hoare does lose her pivot, however, but pushing hard against the arch rival wall. Swanson gets out just now on the initial pass while Curly Hoare comes in for the second scoring pass, keeping one eye on Swanson for sure. Look at that 360 juke around the outside of three to pick up another full scoring points.
Nice tippy toe right there on the outside in that rotation. So important. Curly Hoare grabbing those points and trying to put some more on the board.
Swanson is also now coming in for a second scoring pass, but the speed that's been put on the pack just now, we've just done a whole lap of the pack in less than 7 seconds, and it's really not showing any signs of letting up just yet, making Curly Hoare and Swanson work hard for the next scoring pass.
It's like they're doing their lap test for minimum skills.
But Curly Hoare now taking advantage of the stoppage that's been put on the pack, gets through for another scoring pass to take the team to 13 more points.
Beautiful offensive assist there by Dykstalker, clearing a pathway for her jammer. And Curly Hoare knocked out at the apex, forced to recycle. But we have a bit of a sandwich situation with our offense and defensive formations. And again, those toe stops on the inside.
But
no.
Cut track penalty given to Curly Hoare with 5 seconds left on the jam clock. Curly Hoare slightly moving with a little bit of slowness to the penalty box. So a power jam start going into jam 14 for arch rival.
Now, if I'm not mistaken, this might be the first power start for arch rival. It is indeed. And this is the first jammer penalty. And here we see that's where the step out happened. Oh, just barely. Now, the camera angle, for those of you that are on Twitter, you're going to freak out and say, no, you know, that's in. The angle can sometimes cheat.
Yeah, it deceives your eyes. But we are seeing a timeout being called by Crime City.
This timeout is brought to you by Quad Skate Shop. If you've got bad knee pads, replace those smelly old ones with the new set at Quad Skate Booth or at quadrollerskateshop.com.
Yeah, keep some wonderful replays. Keep your tweets coming in, hashtag talk to WFTDA. We're also seeing some dogs of WFTDA come in, as well as some cats of WFTDA. But we have people going, Hannah Pays line work, sharp as a knife. Completely agree. Looking at those penalties, we just have two people sat on three with 10 minutes left of the first period.
Now, overall, the penalties have been relatively even. Arch with 12, Crime City with 15. And going into this game from their previous performances, Crime City was much heavier on their penalties compared to their opponents. And so it looks like they've taken heed of those earlier games, learned from it, and now they're trying to play a little bit cleaner.
And so the team timeout comes to an end. Everyone now ready and in position. 5 seconds has been called with a power jam start for arch rival. Psycho Kid is the one taking up the star.
Nice teamwork there. And there's that kind of whip fan, if you will, that I mentioned it last night, that Crime City is really good about holding together a three wall, but turning it vertically so that it doesn't take up the whole four lanes of the track necessarily, but it's enough to swing someone out of bounds.
Yeah, Miss E. Timmon has gone to the penalty box. And meanwhile, we do have Curly Horse standing, now returning to track, while Kid coming in on that second scoring pass. Curly Horse gonna have to work hard to make up some time to get the initial. But arch rival really not giving up anything. So here comes the offense from Crime City, trying to create that space for Curly Hall to get through.
We have a back blocking penalty called on arch rival's pivot. And Psycho Kid to freak out, trying to get past that last line of defense for Crime City up in the front. I believe that was Goldie Blocks.
Curly Hawes removed the helmet cover from her head, currently holding star in hand. Pivot is right next to and successfully and smoothly passed to Dykestalker.
Crime City has had some of the smoothest handoffs that I've seen, with the exception of that one arch rival one that was just sneaky as all get out.
Yeah, and actually, Dos Pecrotos throughout the tournament were using a lot of star passes throughout, and incredibly well executed as well.
So here's that replay. Here's this isn't the whip I was talking about, but that's that breakdown. When you get too far away from the pack and you lose people one by one, these jammers are just too powerful, and that one-on-one defense tends to be relatively ineffective. Back to the action on the track. Who's jamming, bro?
Yeah, so just 8 minutes left on the clock. We have Reptar and Hannah Pay. Pack advantage sits with Crime City Rollers. Just as I say that, arch rival's blocker released from the penalty box and returns to track. That's Vicious Van Gogh. And Reptar gets through, but...
Oh no, this is going to be a 2 minute jam because Hanape has removed the star from her helmet. From their helmet, even though they were lead jammer. And that's getting handed over to the pivot from Crime City, Dykestalker, who I dare say has been the number one recipient of star passes from Crime City here in this game.
Yeah, 1 minute, 13 seconds left of the jam clock. Both jammers now scoring. Dykestalker trying to take the outside.
Reptar, two laps ahead of Dykestalker with a full complement of blockers from Arch. 4-3 pack advantage for the team in black.
Really nice recycling by Hannah Pay on arch rival's Reptar.
Now, Dykestalker did an interesting thing right there where she kind of fell back into that box formation as if she were still a blocker and used the confusion to jut onto the inside. But Arch saw it and knocked her into the infield.
Dykestalker just pausing, I think assessing the situation before going in and trying to take advantage. We're seeing Reptar with just 20 seconds left on the jam clock, fighting at the back of the yellow wall that is Crime City, all the way from wonderful Malmo. Knocked back off, recycled again. A really tough wall as we're seeing Pack Advantage currently sitting with arch rival. Dykestalker gets through to start putting some points on the board in this jam, but just with seconds left, the jam reaches its natural conclusion.
And that was a 4-point pass by Dykestalker, the only points that Crime grabbed in that jam. I hate to say anything negative, period, but I question the strategy on that star pass. So here we go. Here is that jump around backwards, almost as if she was, I don't know, serving as a backpack to the arch-rival blockers, and that's how she got over.
Bricktator, Ponycat, going toe-to-toe. Just one blocker in the quad skate shot penalty box, Crime City side.
Cutting the track penalty called on Ponycat. Oh, we have another cutting the track penalty being called.
And so it is a power jam for arch rival, who have started to eke out in front.
So oddly enough, we're creeping down to the last 5 minutes of this game. But yesterday when we ended the first half of Crime City Angel, they were at 122-77. So not far off from where the score is right now. This is not insurmountable by any means.
Absolutely. Crime City have shown us that they have, this tournament, been a second half team. And whether we're going to see more of the same as today as we close our Wftda international playoffs in A Coruña remains to be seen. But Ponycat returns to the track and gets through on the initial as a low block was called on 500 Grant for arch rival.
Alrighty, and Ponycat through that pack, now eligible to score points. Bricktator going on the defensive.
Ponycat and arch rival Bricktator side by side. Called off at the last second. Just some deliberation over the points there. You can see the jam ref is consulting with the OPR.
Just got to make sure that those hips were passed. That's the question. So here we have Bricktator trying to juke pass, but there's a bit of that fan formation I was talking about where they're still linked and covering a big section of the track.
And so we have an official review that has been called.
Looks like Crime was granted 4 points on that jam. And I see the cutting the track symbol being challenged.
Yeah, but, well... Both bench coaches from either side currently almost having a conversation between themselves just to establish what exactly happened. Great opportunity to tell you about Bont, lighter, stronger, faster, the original carbon fiber boot.
So it looks like that wasn't actually an official review. They were just having a discussion because the points had not been posted yet. So I think there was concern that the total points were not going to be awarded. But all in all, Crime City coming out of that one with 7 points, arch rival with 16. Let's look at our penalties. That's a lot of letters, Bron.
That is, but actually, I think going as a benchmark against the rest of the tournament, it's not in particularly high.
Well, Crime is starting to fall into some of those patterns we've seen in their previous games. They are now at 19 penalties versus arch rival's 13. So, Crime, those penalties really starting to stack up. And in terms of jammer penalties, though, they're both two jammer penalties apiece. What's Twitter saying?
Well, Twitter, for a start, seems to be continuing the trend for our time in A Coruña with an awful lot of respect and love for Curly Hoare, and rightfully so. On the other side, Derby Twitter watching Crime City this weekend be like, insert an awesome GIF. Which only you can see for yourself if you go and search for the hashtag on Twitter. But we did see a couple more points added. And at the end of that jam, apologies, and after that conversation that took place in the centre of the track, Crime City's jammer is now sat in the penalty box.
We unfortunately don't know what for.
Just yet. it will go up on our penalty score, but chart in a moment, but in the meantime, Swanson is the person that's picked up that is jamming for arch rival.
And I'm being told that Ponycat got a cutting the track penalty, and that's why they are in the penalty box. Oh, forearms, excuse me.
Swanson picked up lead for arch rival.
Swanson, one of the heavy jammers, heavy rotation jammers, I should say, here at this tournament. And Swanson with a nice juke from the inside to the outside. Swanson carrying a bulk and 73% lead jammer status acquisition, like we said before, responsible for 97 points of Arch's 300.
So I'm presuming that Ponycat served two penalties, a cut and a forearms, because, well, the minute's nearly up and of the jam, and only just now Ponycat is returning to the track. So we do have Pack Advantage sitting with Crime City, who don't want to move from turn four right now.
And we have a direction of gameplay penalty called on Dyke Stalker, the pivot from Crime City. So 3-all on the packs. Arch now with a full complement of blockers. And Crime City swinging in to provide some offensive assistance. With a star stash, Ponycat manages to get through.
Ponycat comes in on a scoring pass now. Swanson decides, and jam reaches natural conclusion. So just 2 minutes left on this first period. We've seen arch rival move forward to 161 points with 18 picked up in the last jam. A solitary point picked up for Crime City to take them to 80.
Look at that one-on-one blocking. My goodness, I know I talk about how it's less effective, but hey, when it works, it works. And that was a beautiful hit by Below Me.
I want to be more like Below Me. Incredible blocking work time and time again throughout our time in A Coruña. But it is Kid that picks up lead for arch rival. Curly Hoare is back on track for Crime City. Is juking around, but unfortunately there isn't much in the way of offense or defense for Crime City right now, as their wall becomes two, but was one at the start. Both blockers for Crime City standing in the quad skate shop penalty box.
Very spread out pack over the course of about 30 to 40 feet, and Curly Hoare standing, holding that helmet cover somewhat desperately. It looked like, please take it, please take it, but it was a trick. She uses the confusion to jump out and is now eligible to score points.
But decides to call it off with just under 1 minute left on the period clock. The Kaya Topaz, this is no ordinary skate. Are you ready to experience ultimate comfort and performance at an extremely affordable price? The Kaya Topaz, it's time.
I like Topaz, it's my birthstone. And I like Kaya skates. They look really cool and kind of futuristic. So I can't see the future, but I can tell that this is going to be a good jam because Bricktator is facing off against Hanape.
Yeah, and Crime City wrapping themselves around Bricktator to try and stop her in her tracks. But it's an incredibly difficult thing to do, as just demonstrated, as Bricktator picks up lead, but Hanape is less than 10 feet behind her, both coming in on a scoring pass.
Sometimes I can't tell if Bricktator likes jamming or blocking more because she does both of them at the same time.
And Crime City, incredibly quickly at the end of that jam, calling an official review. So we're just going to throw to our head ref, who's going to let us know.
Crime City are using their official review as a timeout.
Thank you.
They do not retain it.
Thank you very much for that.
Can you retain an official review if it's a timeout? Like, you won that timeout. Congratulations. You get another one. Here, this collision that happened right here.
Just as it was, simultaneously
look at
caller.
Face.
Bricktator is not happy. Points immediately to Hanape. But no one sat in the penalty box. There is 4 seconds left on the period clock.
Penalties, and more penalties.
Yeah, but like, you're right. We are seeing quite a few, especially on the Crime City side, with the direction of gameplay penalties.
There's a lot of them. I mean, that's what happens when you play that, like, that slugfest, slow, controlled defense.
Yeah,
it's
taking
very,
every inch where
yes,
you can. Yeah.
It's very prone to, you know, just one movement in the wrong direction, it's direction of gameplay.
And arch rival now responding to Crime City's official review, which was used as a timeout, with an official review.
Now actually this, reviewing something.
Yeah, now this one looks like they are going to be reviewing something. We can see all of the officials gathering. So Duncan Disorderly hopefully will be bringing us a bit of an update. I wonder if it's something to do with that call off right at the end. But we'll let Mr. Disorderly tell us very shortly. Rydell Skates, the innovative leader in roller skates for over 70 years.
And it looks like...
Well, we'll hand you over to Duncan.
Arch Rival also used their official review as a timeout.
They do not retain it.
Thank you very much, Duncan Disorderly.
I love when both the coaches go out there and it's a timeout and it looks like they're having this really intense discussion, but it's really just, I'm using a timeout.
And I'm going to tell you I'm using this timeout. So official reviews / timeouts come to an end and we see Swanson picking up lead incredibly quickly for arch rival Crime City's Hannah Pay is sat in the penalty box.
Power jam for Swanson. And it looks like Hanape picked up a back-blocking penalty on that collision that we were talking about previously. Very interesting pack formation right off the line, and it's now turned into the traditional dual tripod defense that we've seen thus far. We've got a goat in the back as Belomi, who's normally a huge playmaker, but when she's trapped, there's only so much you can do.
Oh, and look at that attempted apex jump from Hanape. The world, the Twitterverse at least, willing her to land it. So it gets recycled back to the start of turn two, juking around the outside of a full-strength arch rival wall.
That's right, Quadskate. Shot penalty box is completely empty, and we've got some traversing of the track happening with both jammers being shoved out of bounds on opposing sides. Offensive assist now by arch rival.
Yeah, and we're starting to see some bridging from Les Roll. As the pack starts to get stretched out, it accordions back together and Hannah Pay gets through on the initial pass. And with that, the period clock had expired and the jam is called off. There's the rolling whistle. So at halftime, we're seeing Crime City at 80, arch rival 102 points ahead.
Still
with 182.
You know, after calling last night's game, I think Crime City can do anything, and that 102 points is still totally doable. However, it's not doable if they don't control these penalties. Lots of direction of gameplay, and in terms of the jammer penalties, that's what's really killing Crime. They've got 5, whereas Arch only has 2. Arch playing a bit cleaner with fewer players with penalties, period, and only 2 players with 3. Nobody really in danger on either side right now, though.
Yeah, well, I mean, but it's just worth noting, Les Roll has picked up 3 direction of gameplays in the first period. So it's just a case of staying put and not going anywhere. A big thank you to Atom. Savant Wills by Atom, light, fast, responsive, everything you can look for in a will, as you know, they're just there, they're behind us. So thank you very much, don't go anywhere, and join us back here shortly on WFTDA.tv. And welcome back to A Coruña, here in wonderful, slightly humid, but beautiful Spain. Thank you for joining us for the final game, the conclusion of international playoffs hosted by the Women's Flat Track Derby Association. Thank you so much for being here with us.
I'm Scarlett O'Hurtia.
And I am Brom. And when you left us, we saw that the score was 182-80, arch rival to Crime City. And just looking down at some of the points breakdowns so far, thank you to our wonderful producer, Mr. Whistler, we can see that most of Crime City's points have been picked up by Curly Hoare, who has scored 46% of the 80 points, that's 37, of Crime City's, whereas Swanson, for arch rival, has picked up 64 points, 35% of arch rival's 182.
So not an insurmountable point differential here for Crime City, but as somebody, you know, the camera caught me as I was checking Derby Twitter, and somebody said, we don't know if this can be a three-peat comeback for Crime City, but dang it, they're gonna
never
try.
Never say never. Yeah, with because these guys.
This team. Last year at championships, They were super disappointed that they came all the way from Sweden and got knocked out in the first round. So they really wanted to play Angel yesterday. They really wanted to beat Angel yesterday. And I think playing and beating a much higher seeded team like Arch would be a huge boon for them.
And looking at the leads just very quickly, Crime got four leads, lost two of them, whereas Arch Rival have 16 and lost one. So not necessarily completely reflective, but... And you've got some penalty stats there for us as
well? Yeah, the penalties are what have been killing Crime. They've had a grand total of 25 in the first half. Arch with only 16. Jammer penalties 5 and 2 respectively. And we're going to get back to the action on the track. Who's Jim and Brum?
We have Brick Tater for Arch Rival, Curly Hoare for Crime City. Crime City in yellow, Arch Rival in black. If you're just joining us, welcome. No lead as yet, 20 seconds gone off the second period. And we're seeing Curly Hoare being recycled beyond. And Brick Tater picking up lead for Arch Rival. An incredible quick lap of the track means that Brick Tater's coming in on the scoring pass, bulldozes through the pack. Some great gifts to explain exactly how people feel about Brick Tater's absolute demolishing of the pack each time coming through on a scoring pass. Curly Hoare currently holding the helmet cover in hand.
Yeah, but she tried that before and it was here, desperately, take this hack, gotcha. Nope, not going to pass it.
Yeah, and we can see that Pivot is stood incredibly close by as Brick Tater sails around the outside of Turn 4 to get a third scoring pass, just teetering on the edge of 200 points for Arch Rival.
Now, Crime City had a very unique point where they need to be extra aggressive on their offense to close that gap. But at the same time, if they switch purely to offense, which I've seen them do a little bit here in this jam, it's really going to be detrimental to them because Brick Tater will not hesitate to rack up 20, 30, 40 points.
So there was still 25 seconds left on the jam. It took 1 minute 30 for Curly Hoare to get out. And Crime City did lose two of their blockers to the quad skate shop penalty box in addition as well.
Here's that replay of Brick Tater with the backpack dodge is what I'm going to call it, the backpack dodge.
Community orientated like no other, Quad Shop is passionate about getting you what you want faster, cheaper, and friendly. Check them out in-store online at quadrollerskateshop.com.
Back to the action on the track. We have Hannah Pei jamming for Crime City and Swanson, who was Arch Rival's top point scorer in the first half, jamming for Crime City.
Hannah Pei taking a knee at the back of Arch Rival's wall, but picks up lead is Swanson. Pack advantage still firmly sitting with Arch Rival. Hannah Pei also removing the star. Held in hand, sails around the outside and completes initial for Crime City while Swanson comes in for that second scoring pass and a bit of a cacophony taking place on turn two amongst the pack. Speed picks up, allows room for Swanson to sail through.
Very interesting stuff happening in the pack. We're not seeing the same formations that we saw in the first half for the most part. A lot of braiding and Arch throwing their offensive assistance in a little bit more frequently than they would normally. 5 points on that pass for Swanson.
Yep, and Swanson now completed three scoring passes, comes in for the fourth. Hannah Pei, 1 minute and 15 seconds down with a successful star pass over to Bricken, which forces the call-off.
Looks like 3 points on that last pass for Crime City, but Arch Rival coming out with the better end of that jam with 14.
Yep, 17 it takes them to. So they've just gone past the two-century mark and then added good 17 points, keeping Crime City comfortably below 100 for the moment.
We're heading into jam number three here in the second half. This game, again, is for gold and silver. And with the way Curly Hoare is skating right now, you can tell she wants that gold.
Yeah, remember, both of these teams are guaranteed to go to champs. Now it's a case of deciding who's coming out on top here at international playoffs. But you can tell both desperately want to go home with that gold medal. Kids, the current lead for arch rival, who lose two blockers to the penalty box.
Golden opportunity for Curly Whore to jump on through and rack up some points. And with a hop to the outside, looks like we're going to lose two Crime City blockers for a direction of gameplay penalty. Interesting, they're going 2x2 to the penalty box.
Yeah, that's it was responded appropriately. And then a back block penalty has been given to Kid. So Arch currently with three in the box, two blockers and Kid. And Curly Whore has completed that initial as well. So comes in for a scoring pass. Kind of says goodbye to one of her own blockers in the process, but just two players to come up against. Arch's pivot number 15 returns to track, bolt action, sweeping offense on turn four. Look at the footwork!
Oh, good track awareness right there. Wasn't called, and she was looking at the ref like, did I stay? And she sneaks by on that outside. 4-5 points, excuse me, on that scoring pass, so evened out.
And now the quad skate shot penalty box is emptied as Curly Whore comes in for a second scoring pass, takes to the inside. Less than 20 seconds left on the jam.
That was a beautiful jammer takeout there to the infield, I believe, by Grant from arch rival. And we have Crime City's pivot once again heading to the quad skate shot penalty box, and this is her sixth penalty.
Yeah, Kids getting one final scoring pass before the jam reached its natural conclusion to add another 13 points to arch rival's score, but 9 added for Crime City, which takes them to 92.
Now here's that replay of what I believe the penalty is being served for, and the stumble through doesn't have to be graceful, just has to be effective. Stay in bounds and get your points, be done with it.
Reptar for arch rival, Hannah Pay for Crime City. Reptar takes a tumble to the outside of turn two. No pass, no penalty being declared, so left lead open for Hannah Pay, who responds by going, I'll have that, thanks very much.
And a quick call off. Didn't want to risk a situation that we saw earlier, and I believe Hannah Pay was the jammer in which that happened, where they basically gave up lead jammer status in favor of trying to score more points, but the other team managed to score more. So Hannah Pay with a very wise decision there. And we have an official review out on the track called by
Crime City. The 2018 WFTDA playoffs are brought to you by the popular Rydell Solaris. Solaris, the performance you demand, the comfort you've been missing. So a great opportunity to say a final thank you to our officials who have been phenomenal throughout the 3 days in A Coruña. And that is our head referee on this crew. It's Duncan Disorderly. Reverend Riot joins him. Chop Saw, Feminist Killjoy, Reflex, Bath, Total Miscall, and Logan Nighthawk. You can see bench coach Dr. Stevel there explaining what he's asking the official review for. Do you know, Dr. Stevel has only been with Crime City Rollers for 3 weeks.
What?
Yeah. Has only had a very short period of time to be with them.
Let's wait until after we hear from our head ref on that official review, and then we'll give you our NSOs.
So I don't, not 100% sure if that came through. So
contesting a cut call is what I heard.
Crime City are contesting a cut call.
And here's some of those penalties. The one we're really worried about right now is Bricken, who is currently at 6 penalties and is the one that's currently sitting in the quad skate shot penalty box. Crime with a significantly higher number of penalties. But arch rival has to watch them as well. Mainly more blocker penalties on arch rival's side. And that's really reflected in the score because arch has had their point scores out on the floor most of the time. I believe they only have 2 jammer penalties in the first half and 1 here in the second. However, Crime has had no jammer penalties here in the second half.
So Duncan Disorderly just updating the bench coaches as to the outcome of that official review. We'll let him update us. does seem like a little shake of the head there, but Duncan will inform us best. Over to you, Mr. Disorderly.
The no call will stand. Crime City have used their review for the period.
Thank you very much, Mr. Disorderly. Also a chance to say a big thank you to our non-skating officials, Joe Care, Purple Pain, Pretty Miffed, Domination, Halo Jones, Marilyn Manson, Robert John Lawrence, Emily of the State, Misty Moan, Tem Refuse, Hannah, Hoff and Roll, and that is the crew. Domination signalling the end of the official review. Yoshi with the rather fantastic hair. The huge mohawk.
People have been commenting about that on Twitter. Ponycat now jamming for Crime City. Bricktator for Arch Rival.
And it's in Ponycat trying to put some speed behind Arch Rival, but they're claiming back every last millimeter of space that they can from her.
Straight out of the penalty box, Arch Rival's pivot goes to work, clearing some space for Bricktator, but that follow-up hit right there by number 79, Goldie Blocks, shoving out Bricktator, forcing a recycle back to the jam line. And another nice hit there by Crime City's pivot, Bricken, who is now being sent to the penalty box. I believe this is her seventh penalty, and she is now going to likely be expelled.
So Bricktator picks up lead for Arch Rival, comes in for the scoring pass, found that space exactly where the pack is still sat between turns one and two. While Ponycat yet to get that initial pass as some speed is put onto the pack. And that's given Ponycat the space that she needs to get through and complete the initial pass.
3-2 pack advantage for Crime City, but Bricktator doesn't seem fazed by that in the least. Grabs 5 points. So actually, defense on Crime City really doing a good job on that last jam of holding it down and restricting Bricktator to only a few points. And we do officially have a foul out on Bricken, who is being escorted from the track. New pivot taking over for Crime City. Here's a look at those penalties as we have an official timeout on the track and some shuffling of position.
Yeah, so Goldie Blocks on four at the moment. They'll be looking to watch a variety of penalties, I hasten to add.
All the letters.
And then on the other side, a very clean game from Arch Rival. Bolt action just sitting on four. And the official timeout has been brought to an end.
I think the important thing is none of the jammers from either team are in any kind of danger of fouling out. However, losing Bricken is going to be a significant blow to Crime City's defense. Not a blow to their defense, in fact, a boon to their offense. Curly Horror jumps out in front with a spin move to the inside, and she is your lead jammer for Crime City.
Yeah, the crowd have cheered incredibly loudly to celebrate that. But Curly Horror takes a tumble to the floor and is recycled back, and one of Arch Rival's blockers goes to the box. Curly taking another slide across turn one, but gets through on the scoring pass while Swanson completes the initial.
So one lap ahead for Crime City. Let's see if Curly can grab any points. Beautiful little hop right there. I won't even call it an apex jump. It was just as if you were jumping over a puddle.
And
very small.
Yeah. And with that, Crime City have broken the century mark. 9 points picked up by Curly Hall to take the team to 101, and just take a moment to appreciate some of that work from Curly Hall using her full body to push back on Arch Rival and get through on the inside.
That was another one of those backpack moves that I was talking about, firmly placing her foot behind the blocker in front of her in order to facilitate that rotation right in the straightaway. Back to the action on the track. Hanape jamming for Crime, Psycho Kid to freak out for Arch Rival.
Yeah, and we've seen a cut track given to Hanape. Hanape thought that she was going to get a no pass, no penalty, but it's off to the box, so Kid has a power jam, but is yet to get that initial pass.
Full complement of blockers for Crime City, and Arch losing one blocker slash pivot to the penalty box. A lot of shuffling on the tracks. Kid really forcing Crime to demonstrate their agility to keep up with her.
And there's that lead after 40 seconds secured by Kidd, racing in for a scoring pass to capitalize on the time that Hannah Pay's being called off in the box, who's just been released. Arch rival prepare for her arrival. Look at the speed at which Hannah Pay arrived at the back of the pack.
Well, and I want to point out right before this pass, the speed at which Psycho Kidd managed to get around that pack completely untouched and grabbing another scoring pass.
Kidd comes in for the third scoring pass. The pack is densely populated right now. 7-9, just losing balance and taking a sit on, that was Goldie Block taking a little sit on Kidd's shoulder for a second, but a cut track's been picked up by Kidd, so 30 seconds left on the jam.
Oh, the tables have turned.
They have Hannah Pay looking to capitalize on that. Pivot is close by, and there it is. We've seen the star pass again go to Dykestalker, not for the first time this game, who completes the initial pass.
Dykestalker, one of those really good utility players that every team needs on their bench, that you can just throw into any situation and they're going to make moves happen.
Like that tool in the kitchen that just does everything.
Right. Like it slices, it dices, it makes julienne fries. And with that, the jam comes to a close and we are going to have a power jam start for Crime as Psycho Kidd to freak out is currently in the quad skate shop penalty box. Here's that hop to the outside. Oh, one step. Oh. Trying to reset.
And that was the cut track on 810, thinking it was a no pass, no penalty, but it was called.
Man, I got to give props to these referees because seeing that in real time and being able to react
that
so quickly
and make that accurate call.
I'm glad I'm not a ref.
Says the high level of officiating that is here and with us this weekend. But we've seen a cut track penalty given to Curly Hoare as Kidd was released from the penalty box. So Kidd's coming in to try and complete that initial pass.
I was about to say that was a beautiful jammer take out there by number 9 from Crime City Kicks, but she got a low block penalty for that hit.
Kidd being recycled again. Crime doing a good job of trying to use as much time as they can to release Curly Hoare from the box, who's now standing, waiting eagerly to be released back to the track. Meanwhile, Kidd's picked up lead. Curly Hoare returns.
Both jammers hitting the back of the pack at about the same time, taking opposite paths through the pack. And we have a bit of a jammer sandwich going on. Arch forming the back line and Crime on the front line. Looks like we have a penalty forearm called on Kidd. Nope, just joking. That's actually going to go to number 1 from Crime City below me as Kidd gets through for 4 points.
Curly Hoare having a bit of a hard time using those jukey toe stop moves on the inside of turn 4. Moves to the outside. Oh, two double 360 turns to get past. A sign of appreciation. Mini applause up here.
I'm doing like a quasi golf clap in order to say I appreciate that movement. And I also appreciate our wonderful sponsors like Bont. They're fully heat moldable, ultra lightweight, and extremely responsive. They have heavenly heel lock. Bont.com is where you can go get your own.
Sarah Francis asking, who's the coach with the Packers hat? That would be Dr. Stevel.
Who's new to Crime City, not new to Crime City, is the jammer donning the star right now. That is Hannah Pay, but your lead jammer is Reptar. Hannah Pay being sent to the quad skate shop penalty box.
So it's open and taken by Reptar, who comes round at immense speed on the scoring pass.
Back to the action on the track. We have a full complement of blockers for both teams. Hannah looks like she's just chilling in the box. Sorry, they just chilling in the box. And we have a braided pack out at turn 1. And it looks like Crime City with a pretty effective penalty kill right there. Got a handful of points on the board for Arch. However, Hannah is standing. So here's where we're going to see that penalty occur. And a bit of a... That was a back block, yeah.
Big shout out to OHeyAK_47 on Twitter. Said, didn't think I'd ever love another skater as much as I love Lady Trample, but Brick Tater's coming pretty darn close this weekend.
I'll throw Curly Whore into that mix as well.
Yeah,
like,
me too.
Like the trifecta. Oh. And out on the track, we have Hanape with a bit of a spill to turn one. Both jammers forced to recycle back to the jam line.
Yeah, Hanape going all the way back, and now Brick Tater returns as well. But it is Hanape that picks up lead for Crime City.
And they haven't had lead in the last three jams, so golden opportunity. They've only had lead three times in this half, so they have to maintain that, though, not lose it to a penalty.
And were we going to see one of these higher point-scoring jams for Hanape? Arch rival are really firmly holding them in their place.
We
not
have,
letting up any space.
Sorry, arch rival sending Lux Furious to the penalty box as Brick Tater manages to get through. And Hanape still in control of that clock and the scoreboard. Quickly gets her points, calls it off.
I really like that Hanape, as the second she got through, looked back at the bench as if to say, am I calling this off? And Dr. Steve was going, yeah, call it off.
So here we see that beautiful footwork by Brick Tater.
Matrix move.
And a very nice counter to a very physical hit right at the apex by Crime City. Now, one of the newer jammers to the Crime City roster, that is Velvet Crush, facing off against Swanson.
And it's Swanson that gets through for Crime City. Just one of Arch Rivals players currently sat in the quad skate shop penalty box. Velvet Crush has got out of the pack as well. It's coming in on the scoring pass. Were any points given away there? Yep, the jam ref says you can have 1 point for passing the opposing blocker.
Only one.
Just the one.
Only one. That's all you get. Can't come back for seconds. 263 to 110. We are in the last 12 minutes of the game. We're heading into jam number 12. Anything witty from Twitter?
Yeah, we're saying we've seen a lot of love saying Kayla Woodward with that knife precision strike on Curly and drawing the cut. Good Lord, hashtag talk to WFTDA. Curly Whore on the track with Kid.
Curly with the chasse to the outside lane, manages to stay inbounds and grabs lead jammer status.
And
below me, that last line of defense, once again, Star Stash to get Kid through that pack.
Curly Hall coming in on the scoring pass, sees Kid coming and goes, nope, I am just going to take the 4 points that I had successfully secured and add them to my team score. Thank you very much. And it takes them to 114 for Arch Rivals 263.
Here is a replay of that matrix move by Curly Hoare and the shove to the outside and the quick recovery. Bit of a figure skater back crossover to re-enter the pack.
Steve Toy suddenly feeling that this is the last 10 minutes of international playoffs, and so we are joining you with the immense sadness. But there is still 10 minutes of great gameplay to come, because Hanape picks up lead for Crime City. Reptiles caught up in the pack. Crime reforming around her incredibly quickly, but the initial is sought while Hanape is on the scoring pass.
This is Hanape's This is the team's fifth time to get lead jammer here in the half.
Yeah, Hanape very happy about that as well. Big smiles all around.
Happy Hanape.
High fives for going back to the bench. And this is that moment that lead was got.
Where we see the backtrack. Sometimes you just got to rewind in order to jut forward, and that's prime evidence of just that. I believe we're going to have a timeout on the track because we have no arch rival players on the track.
Yeah, they ended up waiting until the last second. I was like, either that or it's going to be a very odd jam.
So I would just like to know how Arch's coach has a sweater on right now. You'll notice that
it is
Dr. Stevel.
We are about, I want to say we're probably about 40 feet up from the track right now. So that was Code Adam in the sweater.
Very different from the crop top we saw yesterday.
It is. It's an incredibly strong look, though.
So Adam Skates, we want to give them one more shout-out. Skate for the love of it. Jackson and Adam are the best combo around. You can also get colored Pilot Falcon plates, a great option for a great price at Adam Skates. Come back, penalties. Come back.
There they are. Oh, our string crew are wonderful. You can just see at the moment, below me is on four, Hannah Pay on four. We've got Goldie Blocks there on four. And then on the other side, Bolt Action and Grant. Thank you.
Empty quad skate shop penalty box. So full complement to blockers, both jammers, all wheels on the floor. Who's jamming, Brom?
So you've got Curly Hoare is back. Brick Tater for Arch Rival. Curly Hoare is pushing all four Arch Rival blockers and making, I mean, it's a small amount of headway, but that is four people.
An inch is an inch. That's it. I mean, like, take what you can get, because you never know when that amount, the amount of pressure that those jammers are applying when they're doing that sludgy slow derby. Okay, so Curly Hoare is declared lead jammer, but was forced out of bounds. Very smartly pulling back to do a recycle. Nice follow through there by Belomi.
Yeah, Curly Hoare is in control of the clock right now as Brick Tater comes in for the scoring pass. Curly Hoare shuts it down.
And that was a beautiful jammer takeout right there on the inside. And I apologize. I believe that was Vicious Van Gogh. And you can see, okay, so I joke about the sweater because look at Dr. Steve's shirt, which is drenched in sweat.
With falafel, nudity, and roller derby on the back.
All life's essentials, right? All the essentials. Essential to this next jam out on the line for Arch Rival. We have a very familiar jammer. That is Swanson.
And Hannah Pay. And Hannah Pay does not hang around in picking up leads. In seconds, got through. And comes in for the scoring pass with great speed. Swanson yet to get the initial pass.
Now this is Crime's fourth lead jammer status in a row. So maybe this is where we see things shift, but we didn't see a lot of scoring when they had lead.
No, we haven't, but Hannah Pay has now picked up 10 points, comes in for the third scoring pass just as Swanson completes the initial. Has to put one hand out of bounds, returns, gets through on the scoring pass, but as does Swanson.
Four all on that pass. Beautiful track awareness by both of those jammers.
And Hannah Pay just trying to add a handful more points to the board and a brilliant 17 points added to take Crime City to 1-3-5. Arch Rival just four in that jam.
That is the highest point so far this half for Crime City, up in the double digits with 17 points. Score is currently 267 to 135. Arch Rival in the lead.
Dr. Alex Hanna on Twitter says, thanks to the producer for these for this game, for the hot, hot stats. Thanks, Mr. Whistler.
Applause, applause. And applause for the jammers out on the line right now. That is Ponycat for Crime City and Psycho Kid to Freak Out for Arch Rival.
Very static on turn one. The two teams close. Nice. Side by side. And look, again, Ponycat picks up lead for Crime City, now making it five in a row.
Pat getting a little jumbled up in the front, particularly Crime City's defensive formation. I'm running out of breath. I'm so excited.
But we're seeing that it's a three wall with a little bit of offense going in to try and help Ponycat out on the scoring pass. Ponycat just about to find some space to get through and is shut down and picks up a cut track, so loses lead while with a minute and 10 seconds left on the jam clock.
Excuse me. Kid being shoved from one side of the track to the other, from one blocker to another. And right now, all Art should be doing is playing offense, which they do eventually. But Crime City doing a pretty effective job at a penalty kill right now. Successfully burning about 20 seconds of that penalty. Psycho Kid to Freak Out with a star stash to get through on that initial pass.
Now coming through on the scoring pass just as Ponycat is released. 30 seconds still left of the jam. And a Brilliant hit to the outside. Crime City are recycling back.
We just saw below me the pivot from Crime City head to the quad skate shot penalty box for a... we're seeing a second jammer penalty for Ponycat in this jam alone, a forearm penalty. And that's going to be number 5 for both of them.
Yeah, so a little bit thin out there on the Crime City side while Kids takes both knees as the jam reaches its natural conclusion. The Kaya Onyx. This is how skates are supposed to feel. Try the Onyx boots on today and see for yourselves. That's Kaya, CHAYA-brand.com.
Now, if you saw that, there was a lot going on in that instant replay. I can't even break it all down. We had people literally going face to face, toe to toe. Lots of reactive, responsive blocking there. And speaking of reactive and responsive, this is Bricktator, one of the most reactive and responsive jammers I know of in the game today.
And that power jam start working in Bricktator's favor, picks up lead while Ponycat just stands in the box. That finger wag meaning something was communicated there to the fellow teammates.
Well, Bricktator communicated something to the other team with that beautiful apex jump. I mean, that was like picture perfect in the textbook, how to do an apex jump.
Meanwhile, Ponycat's rejoins and pushing hard. Pivot is close by if Ponycat wants it.
Nice jammer takeout, but I believe we're going to see a penalty for that one on number 53, Dyke Stalker. Pivot for Crime City.
Yep, the third blocker penalty we've seen on the Crime City side this jam. But a seamless cut through the pack for Bricktator on the fourth scoring pass. Takes them to 19 with still just under a minute left. And a second cut through the pack on the inside of turn 3. A jump over the inside.
So that was like an advanced apex jump because that was like high knees, legs forward, torso back. Some like long jump type stuff.
And another scoring pass takes them to 29. The 300 mark has been broken, and we've seen a star pass on the Crime City star. Dyke Stalker picks up the star, and I think the arch rival can be incredibly happy with that, with the final scoring pass taking them to 33 points in the jam. 305 now for arch rival plays 138 for Crime City.
And that is the highest scoring jam of the game so far. We have a timeout called on the track. There's that beautiful picture perfect apex jump, and here is apex jump number 2, I'm guessing. And that's where it's that was a little bit more simplistic than I made it out to be. Excuse me. Oh no, there was the high knees. Bricktator, aka apex jumper extraordinaire. Now let's look at these penalties, which have been killing Crime City here in this game.
So while we're on the Crime City timeout, just take a moment to take in everything. Goldie Blocks on 5 still, has been frozen there for a while, below me the same. Crime City did lose Bricken a little bit earlier on. S1 Helmets, S1Helmets.com, durable, functional, stable. The S1 Pro knee pads are built for roller derby.
Some of the spills we've seen out here today, you need good knee pads, for sure. And we've got the Crime City Rollers chant starting up once again in the crowd. But we have an official review now on the track called by Arch. Less than 3 minutes left on the period clock. You know, bro, even though we are about done with this tournament here in A Coruña, there is still a lot of derby to be had this season, including championships. And I know at championships, we have special ticket packages left and right, including VIP tickets.
Yeah, you can roll up to WFTDA Champs in style in New Orleans, November 9th to 11th, with a VIP ticket for $150. That VIP ticket will get you
all kinds of good stuff, but the high note is complimentary drinks. Just know that.
Yeah. and a host of other great stuff as well. Make sure you go and check it out. WFTDA.com/tickets.
Full complement of blockers for both teams, both jammers on the track. Quad skate shop penalty box is clear, and we have who jamming?
Yeah, and we're going to see Hanape go head-to-head against Reptar. Reptar picks up lead. Hanapay frozen in that pack, trying to force out some space. Great offense coming in to support Hanapay.
Very spread out pack in the apex.
Hanapay has removed the star from her helmet. It's currently held in hand while Reptar gets through to pick up the full five.
So although we've seen a lot of helmet cover removal, we've actually only seen three star passes executed during this half for Crime City.
Wow.
And yet again, another example of a star stash. Arch not relying on that star pass as much. In fact, we haven't seen a single star pass from Arch here in the second half. 8 points for Reptar, 0 for Hanapay on that last jam. Here's a replay. Reptar going face-to-face with Belomi, who is holding her face. But no penalty is assessed, so we get back to the action on the track.
Quad skate shop penalty box is empty. The hall, the arena, has fallen deadly silent going into one of the last few jams with 1 minute and 30 seconds left on the period clock. Swanson is going up against Curly Hoare. Swanson picks up lead. Curly Hoare still stuck in the pack. Offense is coming in from Goldie Blocks. Curly Hoare doing some matrix kind of moves on the outside of turn one and two to complete the initial.
Swanson with C cuts left and right to get around those opposing blockers. Don't skip footwork agility day, kids.
You see that? There was a Swanson tentatively holding hands over hips, taps them once, but looks and goes, no. And then waits about another 5 seconds. It's like, now I'm ready. Now I'm ready to call this off.
I haven't taken away your hope enough yet. Wait 5 seconds. 45 seconds left on the period clock. We are heading into jam number 20, likely the last jam of the game. 317 to 138. Crime City putting up a valiant effort today.
Incredibly hard worked. Hanapay has returned at the back. Is finding some space, breaks through and picks up lead for Crime City in what could be the last jam of the game. Brictator for arch rival is stuck against a tough Crime City wall who the last line of defense doesn't quite manage to hit to the outside of the track. So Brictator completes initial.
Full PK turn by Brictator there on the outside and manages to get through. We have two blockers, one from each team in the penalty box, and a nice hit right there by Kay Woodward.
Yeah, so Hanapay is gonna be taken to the back of the pack. Meanwhile, Brictator is coming through on a third scoring pass now.
To be clear, Hanapay was still the lead jammer and now removed the helmet cover from her helmet.
So we're going to see the remaining 54 seconds of the jam clock run out. Period clock's already expired. We are literally going to give you every last second of this game.
45 of those left.
Yeah, thanks to Crime City. Hanapay has now secured that scoring pass, comes in for the second, jumps over the inside of turn three to get the full suite of points. Brictator not returning with something very similar, who is on the fifth scoring pass now.
I'm at a loss for words.
I can see that look on your face. We're just really enjoying it as 10 seconds left on the jam.
So earlier we mentioned that one of the reasons you keep all of your players on the floor is because Brictator will not hesitate to run away with the scoreboard. And that is exactly what she has done. And that's the game, ladies and gentlemen, our unofficial final. 342 to 149. Crime City, valiant effort. And although it's a loss, they have still punched their ticket to champs. They're going to walk away from here today with a silver medal. And they're going to get a second shot at championships going past that first round, which is where they got knocked out last year. Beautiful hit right there by Kay Woodward.
Yeah, taking Hanapay down. And with that, the rolling whistle is sounded. The final score has been confirmed, and it is 149 for Crime City, 342 to arch rival. It's now officially official that arch rival are our gold medal winners for the game. But do not go anywhere, because we are going to have an award ceremony before too long. And with that, the MVP for the tournament will be announced. And we don't even know who that is.
No.
So you'd want to be stay tuned for that.
So you want to see these get handed out. But more importantly, you want to see who among all these phenomenal players walks away with that MVP status. Here's the gold medal. Has a little octopus on it, which has been our mascot for the A Coruña playoffs here in Spain. And some very exciting derby we've seen here today, Bron.
We have, and I think both sides impressed with the performance from the likes of Below Me. Obviously, Curly Hoare almost goes without saying, but when Dykstalker was taking those star passes as well, that really helped Crime City out of a couple of difficult spots. Bricktator, well,
she's, I mean, Bricktator, what do you say?
Viewers and Twitterverse alike equally were just like, wow.
Absolutely. Bricktator responsible for 105 of Archrivals points today. Swanson with 90. Kid with 73. Reptar with 34. On the Crime City side, once again, like we've seen in the past, Curly Hoare responsible for 53 points. Hanapay with 46. Pony Camp with 25. And Dykstalker with 8. A look at the penalties. This is what was one of the things that was a huge impact on the game. We had Bricken foul out earlier in the game, and Crime City racking up those penalties, including a handful of jammer penalties. 44 total penalties for Crime City, 29 for Arch Rival. And on the jammer penalty side, 4 penalties for Arch Rival, 10 for Crime City. So we're going to see these teams with fairly decent ranking heading into the championship tournament in November in New Orleans. We hope you're all going to join us there. Go get your VIP tickets. Go get your watch passes. You're not going to want to miss this great roller derby, in addition to what we still have coming in Atlanta in just a few weeks.
Absolutely. And obviously the Continental Cup in Birmingham as well. So it's been an incredible journey over the last 3 days here in A Coruña. We've seen games won by 1 point in the last second. We have seen second half comebacks. We've seen players that have just absolutely won the hearts and minds of the crowd. And in a town, in a city, which has welcomed the international playoffs with open hearts, and to every official, volunteer and the host league, we say a massive thank you, because without you, we could not have been here. To Stockholm, to Philly, to Detroit and Helsinki, Santa Cruz, Paris, Dodsberg, Crotros, Sailor City, Crime and Angel, Rainy and Arch, we say a massive thank you to everyone that's travelled thousands of miles to literally join us here in A Coruña. We say a massive thank you to the Sports Information Committee as well, and to all of everyone at WFTDA who has brought us all together. It's been a wonderful journey.
Indeed it has. What a weekend. And thank you all for tuning in. We really hope you will stay put for the award ceremony right after this and some important information. You know you want to know who MVP is. I have a feeling. I have a feeling Twitter has their own opinions.
They have
about
opinions
that
on this.
They have all the opinions. So don't go anywhere. We're going to take a quick ad break so we can set up all of our lovely medals. Mm-hmm. This is the silver medal that will be going home with Crime City back to Malmo, and the gold, of course, going with Arch Rival back to St. Louis, Missouri, in the U.S. My voice is officially done for the weekend. Thank you to everyone being patient with this awfulness. And hopefully Brom's smooth British accent has made up for it. So I'm Scarlett O'Hurtia.
I've been Brom. And a big thank you to our producer, Mr. Whistler, and tournament head announcer as well. Thank you so much. And don't go anywhere.